pull the trigger and given them the okay to begin development of these subdivisions.
As part of the.
Go ahead.
They have a certain requirement of spec that they gotta go by when they start developing, not all that, I'm sure that they do, but is that all that been in place already?
Yes, we have a subdivision ordinance, okay? And I've got this, some copies tonight, if you would like to get one, as all the items that are required for preliminary plat approval. And so, basically what they do is they turn those in, submit it to me. You know, I do the general review along with, you know, others that need to be involved in that process. And so the ones that you're looking at tonight, there are no issues and we'll have to do them all the time, but I'm gonna recommend that all the preliminary plats.
Location of this on 33?
It's right next to Lincoln Parish Park, right past, I think it's Park Place Boulevard.
Okay.
It's just past there.
Okay.
So the first one here is Piney Hills Estates, unit two.
Do these one at a time or we do them all?
No, sir, we need to do them one at a time.
Mr. Chair, I make the motion that we consider the preliminary subdivision plat for Piney Hills Estate, unit two.
Second?
Second.
Okay. You took your approval.
Yeah, to approve. Yeah.
All right.
All those in favor?
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Stay.
Item B, number four, is the Country Oaks Estate.
Okay, that particular one is located at Highway 822 and Glen Road. All the lots in that particular subdivision are on existing Parish Road, Glen Road. So there's no new streets involved with that. We recommend that the preliminary plat be approved.
Some move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Next one, Chandler Place, located at the southeast corner of Cook and Chandler Roads. This is more of a courtesy submittal because, just to give you a little background on our subdivision ordinance, it only applies if you're subdividing property and any lot created by the virtue of that subdivision is less than 5 acres. If you look at the plat that they submitted, all of those lots are over 5 acres. But it's still, you know, thank you, Neil, for at least, you know, bringing it to our attention so we're aware, you know, of what's going and where. But I would recommend that preliminary plat be approved.
Some move.
I'll second.
That southeast corner of Cook and Chandler. You got a motion?
A motion.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, the last one is a re-subdivision of a existing subdivision. Okay, Moss Point, which is on Highway 3072, just east-west of 33. If you look at your plat, you can see that basically what they're doing is re-subdividing some of those existing lots, making them smaller. But all those lots, they were originally approved in the original submittal of the subdivision and the final plat. They all front on a state road, and so they meet the criteria for any health sewer facilities that may be required in the acreage. And so recommend approval of that re-subdivision.
So move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I have a question before we move.
Yes, ma'am.
Of course. All subdivisions must go through the parish for.
Unless any lot created in that subdivision is less than 5 acres, yes.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah, also, I have, the jury gave me, or the administrator approval to approve minor subdivisions, which basically means, you know, if five or less lots are created.
But there's no rule which says someone who wants to develop a subdivision must come through the parish?
Yes, there is. We have a ordinance that says that that's the case, if they meet the criteria that calls for it. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, might be too late to do anything about it, but I do know where a subdivision is going.
Do you know who's developing each one of these right here?
I think we've got several representatives, whoever you want to speak. Do we have anybody here from Piney Hills Estates?
I'm Justin Rhodes. I'm the owner of Rhodes Properties and Development. We're the owner of that tract of land developed into Piney Hills. I got my brother here, he owns a business with me, and our engineer, Donnie Barker from Moore and Associates.
And then we've got Country Oaks Estates. We've got Neil DeForest here with them.
Casey Allen. I own Country Oaks LLC with my dad, and I'm a real estate agent here in Ruston. Neil's our engineer here who's guiding us down the right path.
And Chandler Place also I helped out on, and that one is on Chandler Road, just south of Cook, and it's 103 acres, which will be divided into 11 lots, all of which have existing.
Who's the developer on that?
Sparta Land Company.
Okay. And then Lost Point. Anybody here from Lost Point?
Maybe Craig Moss, huh?
I'm not sure. No, he lives from there. He's probably on the flat somewhere. Kirkland Associates was the surveyor. I don't see the name.
I ain't got my magnifying glass.
It says the landowner is All Builders LLC, but I don't know who the person is.
Good. Thank y'all for telling us about that.
All right, move on to item number five. Declare item surplus property and authorize advertising for bids.
Okay, we can basically go through these, but we can do that in one motion. If you look at it, just to give you a little history or process, being a governmental agency, state law requires that, you know, if something's no longer needed for what's called a public purpose, in other words, it's reached the end of its useful life, you can't just, you know, sell it. You can't just keep donating. You can't just give it away. You have to follow state statutes and a process that's involved in doing that. And the first step of that is declaring surplus, saying it's no longer needed, you know, for use by the public entity for the benefit of the public. You have to set a minimum price that you can expect to get in the bid, and then you have to advertise it, and you have to publicly open or take bids. And so what we're doing tonight is the first step in that process, which is declaring a surplus and authorizing the advertisement. So we'll get that in the paper, take the bids, get them tabulated, and hopefully by next meeting, you'll have a tabulation sheet and a recommendation to award to the highest bidder on each item.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry. Just to go through them very quickly here to kind of give you an idea. The first three items, A, B, and C, are all highway department vehicles. The printer is coming from the IT department. And the last four items, the backhoe, the drill, the generator, and the backpack blower, are all from the park. So we just kind of lumped them all together.
The last ones are from where?
The park.
And usually it's something that inexpensive as a $40. It's got to, everything has to be on here, obviously.
If it has
something that probably needs to be thrown away.
If it has value, that's kind of a gray area. You can't just take stuff and throw it away. You know, because somebody else may go out and, hey, you know, it has value to them. You know, so you at least have to go through the exercise. In other words, if for instance, this backpack blower, you know, it may be in horrible shape. You do have a little latitude, but something's got to be pretty well scrapped to just throw it away. And so, you know, somebody may be willing to pay $50 to get it
reprinted.
You'd be surprised. You'd be really surprised at, you know, the interest sometimes is generated on something like that.
Yeah, right, right.
And so you've got to at least go through that. If we offer this and we don't get any bids on it, well, that kind of tells us that there's no interest from the public and that that's going to be scrapped. At least you've gone through giving people an opportunity because the property does belong to the public.
Mr. Chairman, I make the motion that we declare items listed A through H as surplus property and authorize advertisement for bids.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
One, like right now, they are listed here. Is any of these in any kind of circulation? They just sitting there waiting?
No, none of these are currently being used
at all.
You know, and it's buyer beware type situation as it where it is, and that's stated in the advertisement. They've got to go, you know, identify and look them over for themselves to determine its what value that they do have. Our purchasing officer, Jared Webb, usually is the one that determines what these minimum prices are. And you know, the market determines the price. We do our best to estimate, you know, what something is worth. We know, for instance, item B, a Mack truck, you know, even if it's got something wrong with it, it's got value. But if we don't get any bids on it at $10,000, it tells us it was too high. So on something like that, we may come back and lower that price, and then you can generate some interest. So, you know, hopefully we'll get rid of all these on the first pass, but, you know, you may see some of them again if we miss the mark on the estimated price. But that's part of the law, says you have to establish a minimum bid.
These are sealed bids? Mail-in bids type of thing?
Either way, yeah, but they are sealed bids. We'll advertise, we'll set a time and date to receive them by, and then we'll open them here in this room. We don't usually open them in front of the jury. But we'll tabulate them in the tab, and then the jury will, you know, review and recommend them.
Good. Okay, on the money received from these, does the money go back into the different departments?
Goes back to the fund that it originated. So the highway, IT, and park will get any funds that are.
Are we eligible to bid on these items?
No.
I buy stuff all the time, I just need to know.
Or any of your immediate family members.
No family members need.
Well, I mean, we need to know that. That's the thing we read. I knew that, but I just wanted to ask.
That's a good question.
Mr. Teresa, in further response to your question, the money goes back to the fund where the equipment came from, and it generally goes as a reduction against the equipment purchases line.
Tell me that last part.
It goes as a reduction against your equipment purchases line on the budget, on the financial statement. So where the line item says acquisition of equipment, if you bought $2,000 and you sold something for $1,500, it would show $500.
Okay. I knew that. That's what it changed.
I just want to make sure everybody else can see it on the stuff.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we realize we've got, you know, 60 people, and so we're being very, very careful to go through and answer any questions and make sure that there's clarification on what we're doing and why we're doing it. So no question is off the table.
Yes.
You need to understand.
Any more questions? Item number six. All in favor?
Aye.
Alright, item number six. Authorized actions for equipment acquisitions.
Okay, we can also do all these about in one motion if that's your desire, unless somebody has some questions or concerns, but I'll run through them really quick. These items were all approved in the budget approval process that we did back in the fall, so they are budgeted for. The asphalt distributor truck, we intend to purchase through what's called a piggyback purchase. Just for sake of clarification, there are multiple ways, being a government entity, that we have to buy things. We can either go out for bid, write specifications, and take bids. We can buy them off state contracts, which are basically contracts that the state of Louisiana has already done. And we can also piggyback on another contract another governmental entity has done to buy a piece of equipment that is similar to something that we have an interest in or that we have a need for. There are some conditions on piggyback purchases. You have to have agreement between the entity that originally did the bid and the dealer. So, you know, you can't make any modifications. The dealer's got to agree to sell you the same product at the same price that the original entity bought it on. And so we have gone through that and everybody's on board to get that done.
Can we piggyback with Ruston or municipalities?
Any municipality can piggyback with any other municipality. So let's say Grambling wanted a distributor truck. They could either piggyback now off Washington Parish's or they could piggyback off ours. So if we went out and bought something, wrote specs, took bids, and awarded it, any entity in the state can piggyback off that. There's a time limit. It's not specified. It's roughly about, you know, 6 months to a year. But like I said, you've got to have the provider of the equipment. The dealer has got to agree to provide it for the same price. And you can't make any modifications. But the asphalt truck that Washington Parish has purchased is pretty much identical to what we use also. So we recommend that. And then you have a couple of pickup trucks, one with a service body and one without. Those are available on a state contract. Basically, that means the state of Louisiana has already gone out for bids on these items. They have a list of, you know, they have an extensive list of trucks, they have equipment, they have desks, they have pretty much anything a governmental entity uses that we have the ability to buy off that. And so, and there are also two John Deere utility tractors that are needed for the highway department that would also be purchased off state contract. So we need authorization to purchase these items according to the means to acquire them.
I move we authorize actions for equipment acquisition.
I second.
All in favor?
Item number 7, authorizing new agreements for capital outlay projects.
Okay, capital improvement program was also adopted, you know, last year, and there are certain projects that we intend to accomplish this year, and some of them are pretty extensive. I'll just kind of refresh your memory for those who don't remember what was approved. We have $750,000 in hot mix overlay projects. Trace Drive, Valley View Road, and the Road to the Park. And generally, these are pretty large projects that you need engineering assistance on to develop the specifications and make sure the projects are, you know, done properly. The other one that we have, basically, are two bridge replacements on one on Eaves Road and one on Walnut Creek Bridge. That's about $1 million worth of bridges, you know, so we need that engineering expertise there, too. So what you're basically doing is giving me the authority to negotiate engineering contracts for those projects.
Mr. Chair, I just want to commend that you give Courtney the authority to do the agreement for the capital outlay projects mentioned.
Second. All in favor? Item number 8, any business for public works?
Mr. Chairman, I have no other business, but as I mentioned, I have some preliminary plat requirements and conditions.